I am Dr. Sabahat Tariq, working as an associate professor of chemical pathology, Sheikh Zayed Medical College, Rahimdia Khan. I truly welcome and admire and deeply cherished by the candid presence of our gem, Chemical Gem Online, and all the worthy guests which are present in this hall under the middle of this gloomy environment of pandemic of COVID-19 flu. So this annual conference of chemical pathology was scheduled to be hosted by this first time by the pathology department of Sheikh Zayed Medical College, Rahimdia Khan, in March 2020. But because of this pandemic, it was postponed and our hearts were broken. Because this was given by the untiring efforts of our head of department, Professor Dr. Muhammad Abdul Rahman Saab, his continuous effort to get the hosting of this prestigious event from the platform of Sheikh Zayed Medical College. But as every cloud has a silver lining, so today we are here to make the history and achieve this remarkable milestone of not only hosting and participating the first ever virtual ChemCon under the flagship of our new leadership, Principal Dr. Tariq Ahmed Saab. So I'll request Principal Tariq Ahmed Saab to come over the stage and grace the occasion. Please, sir. Now I request the head of Department of Pathology, Professor Muhammad Abdul Rahman Saab, to come on the stage. Thank you very much, sir. Now I request Professor Masoodul Haq Saab to come on the stage and please, please. Thank you very much for these dignitaries to honor us on this occasion, sir. So now I actually request our chief guest, Professor Dr. Tariq Ahmed Saab, to give the permission to formally announce the session open. Sir, your permission.
Thank you very much. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. I formally announce the session open.
Thank you very much, sir. Sir has formally announced the session open. Now I will request a well-known, a very good, excellent Qari of Sheikh Zayed Rahimdia Khan and District Rahimdia Khan, Qari Abdul Quddus Khan Saab, to come on the stage and recite few verses from the Quran al-Hakim. Qari Abdul Quddus Khan Saab.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم اقرأ باسم ربك ربك الذي خلق خلق الإنسان من علق اقرأ وربك الأكرم الذي علم بالقلم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم اقرأ باسم ربك الذي خلق خلق الإنسان من علق اقرأ وربك الأكرم بالقلم علم الإنسان ما لم يعلم كلا إن الإنسان ليطغى أن رآه استغنى إن إلى ربك الرجعى أرأيت الذي ينهى عبدا إذا صلى إن كذب وتولى أرأيت إن كذب وتولى صدق الله العظيم.
Jazakallah. Thank you very much, Qari Abdul Qadus Khan sir. Till now we have got 46 participants online. I welcome President Pakistan Society of Chemical Pathology, Professor Brigadier Amir Ijaz sahab, Professor Rizwan Hashim sahab, Head of Department and Professor of Pathology Department from the Fazaiya Medical College, Brigadier Abdul Sattar sahab, Professor Aisha Habib Khan sahab from Aga Khan University, and Professor Ayub sahab from Bahawalpur. And there are so many residents and PGRs who have joined us through this Zoom. Now I will request all the participants and our worthy guest to please stand up in honor of our national anthem of Pakistan. Please, sir. Thank you very much. I welcome Medical Superintendent of Sheikh Zayed Medical College, a vibrant, dedicated, honest personality, Dr. Agha Tohid Sahab, on this forum. I also welcome Professor Tariq Ghafoor Sahab, Head of Surgical Unit 2. To grace this occasion, and Professor Dr. Mazum Ali Atif Sahab for joining us today and honoring us. Moving further, the endeavors of the torchbearers of Pakistan Society of Chemical Pathology to uplift the discipline of chemical pathology are beyond admiration. This regularly organized annual event not only brings the society together, but also provide a platform to enlighten the seeking minds with latest trends and updates. Now I will call the patron of this CAMCON, Professor Dr. Muhammad Abdul Rahman Saab, to come at the dais for his welcome address. Sir, please.
Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Assalamu alaikum. Being a chairman, organizing committee, and ex-vice president, Pakistan Society of Chemical Pathologists, and head of pathology department, I welcome all the respected participants, head of the departments, medical superintendent, and worthy principal, Sheikh Zayed Medical College, Rahim Yar Khan. From the core of my heart, at first virtual conference, CAMCON 2020, and 11th conference of Pakistan Society of Chemical Pathologists at Sheikh Zayed Medical College, Rahim Yar Khan. It was my dream to conduct National Chemical Pathology Conference at Sheikh Zayed Medical College, Rahim Yar Khan. I am extremely thankful to the principal, Sheikh Zayed Medical College, Rahim Yar Khan, and the Executive Council of Pakistan Society of Chemical Pathologists for the approval of this conference. The actual dates of this conference were 21st and 22nd March 2020. And we have a great plan for this conference, including different programs, desert safari, gala dinner, etc. But and arrival of the different national and international speakers at Sheikh Zayed Medical College, Rahim Yar Khan, meeting of executive body of Pakistan Society of Chemical Pathologists, workshops, and many more. But due to current pandemic of COVID-19, we have to put back all these activities, and with the permission of the principal, Sheikh Zayed Medical College, Rahim Yar Khan, and Pakistan Society of Chemical Pathologists, we decided to conduct virtual conference of chemical pathology. So today we are here to serve you all. As you know, that pathology department is the face of the medicine and surgery, and day-to-day changes in diagnostic methodologies with latest instruments, the importance of pathology department has enhanced much more than previous. Moreover, this pathology is the bridge of the basic departments and the clinical departments. From the day first, pathology department is trying to provide its best services with well-equipped and state-of-the-art instruments by highly qualified faculty and staff members. We also engage in different academic and research activities with undergraduate and postgraduate students under the supervision of faculty members. Being a supervisor, I also have the honor to pass our two FCPS chemical pathology students. Two FCPS chemical pathology students and five MCPS students are also doing their academic work. We have more than 10 officers having the MPhil degrees and also PhD degrees to spread their knowledge and experience. We also involve our staff in different training workshops, seminars and conferences. At the end, I am once again thankful to all the respected participants, head of the departments, Pakistan Society of Chemical Pathologists, Organizing Committee of ChemCon 2020, and especially to the principal, Professor Dr. Tariq Ahmed, for their support and encouragement. Thank you very much. Allah Hafiz. May Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala bless all and protect in this pandemic situation. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir. So now, I'm profusely elated to take the opportunity to welcome our chief guest and patron in chief, Principal Sheikh Zayed Medical College Rahim Yar Khan, Professor Dr. Tariq Ahmed, who is also the head of Department of Neurosurgery, a very dedicated, practical, and noble personality. I welcome you, sir, for the dais.
Bismillahir Rahman Rahim. I am really delighted that in the dynamic leadership of Professor Dr. Abdul Rahman, head of our pathology department, he has been very keen to host this conference of chemical pathology, and he was very enthusiastic when he told me that we are going to organize a conference in March. But unfortunately, this COVID pandemic disturbed all the programs throughout the world. And we were also affected by the this pandemic. But I give full marks to Professor Dr. Abdul Rahman and his department and his team, Madam Sabahat Haider, Dr. Nabila, and all the PGs and who have worked day and night to organize this conference. They never lost their heart and kept on working on it, and ultimately they organized this virtual conference. And it is very heartening that so many participants throughout the country are taking part. There will be interactive sessions, and a lot of experiences will be shared by all the teachers, and it will be a great academic experience, inshallah. And I hope that they will help in making a certain further guidelines in the management of patients. And it will go a long way in improving the healthcare of the patients. Chemical pathology has got a very vital role in these days. And although there is an integrated, as every field of medicine, it cannot be separated from the other. Microbiology and chemical pathology are playing pivotal role in the management of COVID patients. The complications, the tests of PCR, the D-dimers, serum ferritin levels, and all the other parameters. Improving the standards and improving the sensitivity and specificity of tests has always been the primary aim of the chemical pathologist. And I pray that this conference is a great success. And it is, I would like to mention here that not only the department of Professor Abdul Rahman has been very enthusiastic in conducting this conference, but they have been
the leaders in organizing the teaching programs for the undergraduate students through internet and although Sheikh Zayed Medical College is a probably a newer entity starting in 2003 and then now, but our students and our teachers have contributed a lot towards the medical education in this country. Our students have won many positions and medals in the exams of University of Health Sciences. And this has been a great achievement. And even in the this era of COVID pandemic, our teachers have strived hard to keep their students busy at homes through internet and through arrangement of learning management systems and conducting lectures and then taking their feedback. Hats off to all the department and all the teachers who are in. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir. Till now, we have got 55 participants online all over the world, all over the country. I especially welcome the guest here, the head of Department of Physiology, Medicine, Orthosurgery, and others who are here to join us and grace this occasion, Professor of, and head of Department of Surgery, Professor Hassan Tabassum Saab. And we have got Professor Abdul Sattar Saab from CMH, Lahore. We have got a professor from Peshawar. We have got Professor Saab from Karachi. I welcome you all again on this ChemCon, virtually conducted first time in the history of Sheikh Zayed Medical College and in the history of Pakistan Society of Chemical Pathology. This would have not been possible without the support of our principal, Sheikh Zayed, Dr. Tariq Ahmed Saab, and our IT department, who have done tremendous job to make this session possible today. Thank you very much, Professor Dr. Bilal Ghafoor Saab and the IT department. So now, moving further, I will request, sir, if you can. So now, I will request the President of Pakistan Society of Chemical Pathology, Professor Amir Ejaz Saab, who is the most cherished personality on this forum, nationally, internationally, a very committed person, a very innovative one, and a resourceful too. He has got a long list on his credits. Cutting it short, he's a distinguished graduate of Alam Iqbal Medical College in 1983. MCPS, he did his MCPS in 1988. FCPS in 1995. He is a qualified medical educationist, earning the degree of MCPS HPE in 2030. He has got over 112 publications, and he's got the authorship of 6 books and nearly more than 60 scientific paper publications till date, national and international. He is the sitting president of Pakistan Society of Chemical Pathology. Not only this, he was also awarded FRCP by the Royal College of Physicians of Edinburgh in 2011. We welcome you, sir, here, as you have instilled the love of learning and ignited the imagination in every successful candidate of chemical pathology. He has trained many MPhil and FCPS trainees, and currently he is working as a professor and consultant chemical pathologist in Berea International Hospital, Rawalpindi. Over to you, sir. We welcome you. Please give your address. Thank you very much.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. First of all, thank you very much, Dr. Sabat, for this nice words and whatever you have said for me. I really didn't deserve those words, but thank you very much anyway. This is a dream come true. Today is a great day in the history of PSCP, in the history of Pakistani sciences that we have arranged so successful virtual conference. And I always see that there is a blessing also in this trouble disease, in this pandemic, that we have learned a lot how to conduct these virtual sessions, and this will continue inshallah in our future also. And this will save us from traveling for hundreds of miles to other places, and we will be able to conduct these sessions online. I joined the Pakistan Society of Chemical Pathologists as president in January 2019, and our first conference was in my tenure. In my tenure, the ChemCon 2019 was held at Army Medical College, Rawalpindi, in October 2019. And during that conference, we had a very enthusiastic team from Sheikh Zayed Medical College who wanted to host the conference at Imyar Khan. So in our executive council meeting, we decided to hold this conference at Imyar Khan, Sheikh Zayed Medical College, and the dates were fixed by Sheikh Zayed Medical College themselves. But you know all the story, what happened, and how this pandemic affected all walks of our life, and we couldn't hold the actual conference in those days. And then we were quite susceptible. We were concerned when to hold the conference, because we had also planned ChemCon 21 in Karachi in February 21. So the dates for Karachi conference were also drawing very close, and it seemed that we will not be able to hold ChemCon 2020 anywhere, because the interval between two conferences was getting shorter. So this brilliant idea of online conference came from Imyar Khan, and I was so impressed that they are so much well versed with the modern technology, and I really really appreciate this idea. And in our executive council meeting, which was also held online by Zoom, we appreciated this idea, and we said go ahead without wasting much time, and alhamdulillah, this conference is now started. One more thing, that during, this is not an easy thing, I tell you. All those who are listening to it, all those more than 50 participants who are at different sites in Pakistan, this is not an easy thing. We have held a rehearsal for that. And many rehearsals, I don't know how many rehearsals Sheikh Zayed people have done by themselves, but at least two or three rehearsals they have done on Zoom with us, with the executive council. So a lot of hard work, a lot of what they say, midnight oil has been burned to make this conference a success. And we all give full appreciation, hats off to them, hats off to all the team of professors, Dr. Rahman, including Dr. Sabah Tariq, Dr. Bela Rao, and Mr. Ali Malik. And these are the only few names which I know. And there are many more workers who work behind, especially their IT department. This is the show of IT. And I'm so impressed that IT department of Imyar Khan, they are well versed with all the technologies. And if we had to hold this conference in Islamabad,
So thank you very much, sir, for rejoining us, please.
The purpose was to hold these annual conferences and courses very regularly. And we have been, alhamdulillah, holding such activities. And we are also publishing a newsletter by the name of the Spectrum. And up till now, we have published about 8 editions of this newsletter. In addition to that, we have also published many books on chemical pathology. It included books on pediatric metabolic disorders and endocrine disorders and quick interpretation of data. And lastly, we in 2018, we published a short textbook by the name of Chemical Pathology for the Beginners. This book was meant for postgraduate students and undergraduate students both. So now, alhamdulillah, we are planning to publish 2 or 3 more books, including one on acid-base disorders. So chemical pathology, as was told by earlier speakers, including Principal Saab, that it is playing a very vital role in day-to-day management of patients. About 70% of laboratory tests, they pertain to chemical pathology. And if somebody says that chemical pathologist is not needed because the test is done by the instruments, that means you are leaving those 70% tests and an important part of the patient management to the machines and not to any senior consultant or any pathologist. So it is not like that. Every test has to be supervised, monitored, and those laboratories, we can see clear difference of laboratories which are manned by chemical or properly qualified chemical pathologists. They are doing very well. As also mentioned by Principal Saab, Professor Tariq, that in this crisis of COVID-19, chemical pathologists are playing very important role, not only in PCRs, not only in diagnosis, but also in monitoring the patients. We have a session also in this conference on biomarkers. I will also take up a session on the interpretation of PCR and interpretation of antibody results. My second session will be on quality assurance, quality control of PCR. Want to mention a few biomarkers which are purely dealt by chemical pathologists. They are IL-6, they are D-dimers, ferritin, lipid profile, and CRPs, etc. And just to add in a lighter tone, we are fighting not only on technical fronts, we have to fight on administrative issues also. There is a lot of problem. There are a lot of problems in procuring the reagent kits for these tests these days. So we have to fight the market factors also in procuring these kits so that our clinicians, they are able to manage the COVID patients proper ways. Those chemical pathologists who are in it, they know what I'm saying. So I will again congratulate all the organizers for holding such a wonderful event. Up till now, we can see 57 participants. This is a record number. We have never seen in any of our sessions this number. The last record was probably 55, which was during an AKU conference this year. And congratulations, Sheikh Zayed Medical College, you have broken that record so early in the start of the conference. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir, for your nice words and encouraging remarks. They have always been enlightening us and making us put in more efforts in the best. Now, I will request. This is the most important segment of our every inauguration session of ChemCon. that is this known as the Al Razi lecture. This is given in the memory of the founder of this speciality, Lieutenant General Sayyid Azhar Ahmed late. And this has been, this will be conducted by Professor Dr. Asma Shaukat, and I feel honored to introduce this prolific and generous speaker, who is the head of pathology department of Qaid-e-Azam Medical College. We all know her for her fundamental contributions to the field of chemical pathology, coupled with her impressive background of academics and research. She had done MBBS, BCP, MCPS, FCPS, and FRCP, and she has produced more than 25 brilliant consultants from her institution since 2005. And currently, 10 trainees are working under her supervision. She has got more than 64 publications on her credit, and she is the chief editor of the Annals of Qaid-e-Azam Medical College, Bahawalpur. Now I request Madam Asma Shaukat to please join us and give her address. Thank you very much. Excuse me, ma'am. Sorry to interrupt you, but there is a connectivity issue from your side.
As everybody knows, can you hear me now?
Yes, ma'am. Now we can hear you, but there is a continuous disconnectivity from your side.
Can we start now?
Yes, ma'am, you can start, please.
Okay. So as we all know that when this virus, it enters into the body, the person gets infected and there are certain signs and symptoms that he suffers from. Either he recovers or he dies. Now, when this patient is in this situation, he has to be diagnosed. And in this diagnosis, real-time PCR is the main thing that has to be done. But there is an important role of biochemical monitoring tool that needs to know the staging of the patient, the prognosis of the patient, and therapeutic monitoring of the patient. Now, as far as the patient screening is concerned, according to WHO, there are certain guidelines regarding who is a suspected case. Now, in the beginning, WHO said that a patient with acute respiratory illness plus a history of travel to or residence in a location reporting community transmission of COVID-19 disease during the last 14 days prior to the symptom onset is said to be a suspected case. But as there is an international traveling throughout the world, now WHO has changed the definition of a suspected case. Now they say that a patient is said to be suspected with any acute respiratory illness plus having been in contact with a confirmed case of COVID-19. Now what is a probable case? A probable case is defined as a patient a suspected case for whom testing for the COVID-19 virus is inconclusive, or a suspected case for whom testing could not be performed for any reason. Now, what is a confirmed case? A confirmed case is a person with laboratory confirmation of COVID-19 infection, irrespective of clinical signs and symptoms. Now, upon confirmation of a suspected case, specimens should be rapidly collected and tested. the CDC interim guidelines for collecting, handling, and testing clinical specimens from persons for coronavirus disease 2019, which is updated in April 8th, recommends collecting an upper respiratory specimen for initial diagnostic testing. The following specimens can be collected for swab test-based testing: nasopharyngeal specimen, which is the preferred one, oropharyngeal specimen, nasal mid-turbinate specimen, and anterior nary specimen. Lower respiratory tract specimen testing is also recommended by CDC if the specimens are available. Now, as far as the pre-analytical factors are concerned, they are common as in your laboratories. For example, misidentification or collection of an inadequate material for quality or volume, manual errors, sample contamination, etc. Now we come to a very important diagram. Here you can see three arrows. Arrow number one is showing at the time when the infectious agent is entering the body. And at day zero, the patient shows signs and symptoms. Signs and symptoms peak at the first week, and then the signs and symptoms decrease, and at day 15, they are almost normal. Now, this is called from day 0 to day 15, this window period or this time period is said to be RT-PCR diagnostic window. If during this time we perform the RT-PCR, we will get a positive test. But if on the other hand, we test it on the beginning of the day when the infectious agent entered the body, although the infectious agent is present there, but we are going to get a false negative result at that time. Similarly, at day 20, for example, the fragments of COVID-19 and the virus may be present there, but we are going to get a false negative result. Similarly, there are other analytical factors, for example, active viral recombination, lack of harmonization of primers and probes, instrument malfunctioning, insufficient or inadequate material, non-specific PCR annealing, etc. Now, the biosafety guidelines for clinical laboratory. Laboratories should adopt social distancing measures within the workplace as much as possible and feasible. Similarly, potential exposure and health status of the laboratory personnel should be monitored daily, and what personal hygiene and personal protective equipment are available to the laboratorians, that should be monitored during this pandemic especially. And we must use the biochemical agents to fumigate the laboratory overnight or disinfect the aerosol to be sprayed every 1 to 2 hours on the benches where they work. Now, the laboratory considerations for hospitalized patients. They say that when the person is hospitalized, daily labs of blood complete examination, complete metabolic panel, and CPK levels have to be done. But if the condition is deteriorating, every two to three days, the following tests should be repeated. For example, D-dimers, PT, PT, APTT, fibrinogen, ferritin, CPR, ESR, and LDH, interleukin 1, troponin, and similarly pro-BNP. And if the patient has got kidney injury, serum creatinine, spot urine protein creatinine ratio, they should be monitored every 2 to 3 days. Now, CRP is the most important biochemical marker. It is an acute phase protein produced in the liver that is involved in the innate immune response. Clinically, an increase in CRP level indicates that the body is mounting an appropriate inflammatory response to infection. different reviews have told us that CRP levels, when are between 20 to 70 milligrams per liter, show a specificity and sensitivity of 79 and 77% respectively. Commonly characterized by increased circulating ferritin, serum ferritin levels decrease at a lower rate, but confirmation of this is required. Procalcitonin is, PCT is known for its sensitivity to bacterial infections. Some recent studies also show that the combination of CRP levels and procalcitonin has been shown to accurately help in the prediction of serious bacterial infections. Similarly, higher levels of pro-inflammatory cytokines have been associated with lung damage. Interleukin-6 appeared to significantly correlate with illness severity. CRP levels combined with interleukin-6 levels can also help in differentiation of fungal versus bacterial late onset sepsis. Now comes the ferritin. Ferritin is able to activate macrophages as a part of innate immunity, being the body's first line of defense. When activated, macrophages begin to secrete cytokines. Hyperferritinemia has been associated with increased illness severity by producing cytokine storm and adverse outcomes. Now there comes a very important diagram. This diagram shows us that CRP and ferritin levels can assist in guiding diagnostic and treatment decisions. Here you can see that CRP levels greater than 4 milligrams per liter and ferritin levels greater than 1000 nanograms per liter should be considered highly concerning for severe infection and indicate significantly increased mortality risk. Then comes procalcitonin, which is a septic biomarker. PCT testing on admission seems to be a valuable additional piece of information to help in early risk assessment and rule out of bacterial co-infection in COVID-19 patients. Monitoring of procalcitonin was identified to be useful for detection of secondary infections and progression to more severe disease states like sepsis and septic shock. Procalcitonin, as the precursor of calcitonin, is a kind of glycoprotein without hormone activity, which is significantly increased in bacterial infection, but remain normal or slightly increased in viral infection. Consistently, different studies show that CRP and PCT are markedly increased in severe and very severe COVID-19 and significantly higher in very severe COVID-19. So this further correlates to the implication of the serum ferritin alteration, that most of the severe patients in COVID-19 have viral infection and secondary bacterial infection. Now here comes the guidelines on the use of procalcitonin in COVID-19. When the patient comes to the hospital, he has to get the PCT levels done. If he hasn't got these tests done, kindly send the tests for procalcitonin and start empiric antibiotics. Then repeat the PCT at 48 hours. Now, if the PCT at 48 hours is less than 0.25 micrograms per liter and the patient is stable, consider stopping the antibiotics. On the other hand, if the condition of the patient is deteriorating, consider other causes also, for example, fungal infections and prolonged infections due to steroid intake or the patient may be at risk of immunocompromisation. Similarly, if at admission, the level of PCT was less than 0.25 micrograms per liter, and after 48 hours, it becomes more than 0.25 micrograms per liter, and the patient is stable, continue empiric antibiotics for at least 5 days. On the other hand, if the patient is deteriorating, then reculture is needed, consider re-imaging, escalate the antibiotics, and look for alternative source of sepsis. And if on admission, the PCT level was already more than 0.25 micrograms per liter, and after 48 hours, it still is more than 0.25 micrograms per liter, then again, you need to reculture, consider re-imaging, increase the antibiotic levels, and look for alternative source of sepsis. So in the end, I would say that PCT is a sepsis biomarker. It doesn't significantly increase in COVID-19, unlike CRP, so can help along with clinical assessment with diagnosing or ruling out superimposed bacterial infection for COVID patients and to guide the initiation and cessation of antibiotics. So that is all. Thank you very much for listening. Allah Hafiz.
आपकी आवाज नहीं आ रही रक्सबाग,
जी सर कैन यू लिसन मी प्लीज,
अभी आ रही
सर, आई वाज saying thanks to all the participants here in this lecture hall and all the dignitaries all over the Pakistan, from Karachi, from Indus Hospital, from Ziauddin Medical University, from Aga Khan, from Bulan Medical College, and our ex-president, Professor Asum Tasa. So now, moving further, the second lecture was scheduled to be given by Professor Dr. Ejaz Hassan Saab. He is a very devoted and blessed person, and he remained the president of Pakistan Society of Chemical Pathologists and General Secretary of Pakistan Association of Pathology. He twice remained elected member of Pakistan Medical and Dental Council from KPK province. He is an active member of Drug Regulatory Authority of Pakistan. Currently, he is working as a principal of Northwest School of Medicine, Peshawar. So because he was too much busy in his activities, because he's engaged because of this pandemic, so we are here to play his recorded lecture. Please stay with us.
نحمدہ و نصلی علی رسول الکریم اما بعد اعوذ باللہ من الشیطان الرجیم بسم اللہ الرحمن الرحیم I am thankful to Professor Abdurrahman and Professor Asma Shaukat for giving me this opportunity and I dedicate this lecture to my worthy teachers General Syed Azhar Ahmed اللہ تعالیٰ ان کو جنت نصیب کرے and General Farooq Ahmed Khan اللہ تعالیٰ ان کو لمبی زندگی صحت اور عزت کے ساتھ دے ناؤ کمنگ ٹو دا ایکچوئل پریزنٹیشن دا ٹاپک فار ٹوڈیز ڈسکشن از Perception towards readiness for self-directed learning among medical students at Peshawar. We at Northwest School of Medicine, we started in 2016 and the vision at that time was to have a curriculum which is integrated. So we were examined by Khyber Medical University and the examination was on conventional method. But we taught our students because we wanted to prepare them for the future and make them lifelong learner. So we started with teaching them on integrated curriculum. Later on, in 2018, end of 2018, Khyber Medical University shifted to integrated modular system. Once, when I was just having a round of my institution, I saw that most of the students, they are sitting in the canteen and they are roaming around in the college and the time was for self-directed learning. So I thought that let them have a practical experience of what is the importance of self-directed learning. So for the next week, I struck off the self-directed learning slot. So because I know that integrated modular system, the students are always on their toes. So what happened, the students came to me and they themselves asked for having this slot of self-directed learning. So then I thought to have a pilot study on this, which was initiated and started in the Northwest School of Medicine. With changing time, changing dimensions, changing requirement, there is flood of knowledge and lot of updates are available on almost daily basis, which increases the importance of self-directed learning. Knowles defined self-directed learning as a process in which individual take the initiative with or without the help of others in diagnosing their learning needs, formulating learning goals, identifying human and material resources for learning, choosing and implementing appropriate learning strategies, and evaluating learning outcomes. That is, they take responsibility for and control of their own learnings. Motivation, self-management is the key of self-directed learning. So, in my opinion, SDL must be a part of any good curriculum. Till date, there are three self-rating scales for self-directed learning. And the one we chose was the self-rating scale of self-directed learning, which was developed in 2007 by Williamson. So we conducted a pilot study in the Northwest School of Medicine. So it was conducted on first, second, and third year, and 100 students were enrolled in this study. As I told you that we are working on integrated modular system, integrated curriculum since 2016, when we started establish this Northwest School of Medicine. It was a cross-sectional pilot survey and students we enrolled from our institution, that is Northwest School of Medicine. Study duration was 1 month, sample size was 100 students, and it was convenient sampling. So currently we are having students in first, second, third, and fourth year. So we selected students of either gender from first, second, and third year. And this was the inclusion criteria, and exclusion criteria was those who were not willing to participate. So it was a 5-item Likert-based self-rating scale, a questionnaire which was developed by Williamson, and we did slight changes in their scale. And the response keys were 5 for always, 4 often, 3 for sometimes, 2 seldom, and 1 never. So this questionnaire had 6 parts: demographic variables, students' awareness about self-directed learning, there were 12 items, students' learning strategies regarding SDL, 12 items, student learning activities regarding SDL, 12 items, student evaluation regarding SDL, 12 items, and students' interpersonal skills of SDL, 12 items. So the total items that could be rated were 60, and maximum score could be 300 and minimum 60. And based on the scores attained, the scale was divided into good readiness for self-directed learning, average readiness, and poor readiness. For good readiness, a score of 221 to 300 attained on self-rating scale of self-directed learning. Average readiness, a score of 141 to 220 was regarded as average, and a score of 60 to 140 was regarded as poor readiness. Data analysis was done using SPSS version 24, and descriptive statistics were performed to report frequencies and percentages, and mean and standard deviations were calculated for the scales item. Independent sample t-test was performed to compare mean scores of the genders. So one-way ANOVA was performed to compare mean scores of the group with three or more categories, that is year of study students, and p-value set at 0.05 and 95% confidence intervals were reported. 100 students participated in this pilot study, and the result was mean age of the student was around 18 to maximum 16 years, with half of male gender and half female, and year of study, first year 43%, second year 36%, third year 21%. And the mean score for students for self-directed learning was 217.25 out of 300, that is minimum was 163 and maximum was 297. 43% of students had good readiness for SDL, while 57% had average readiness and none had poor readiness. So mean score of different groups of students were compared. So this is the table which is showing the mean comparison of mean and means and mean differences between different groups of students. In conclusion, overall undergraduate medical students have average readiness for self-directed learning. Gender-wise, male students have good readiness for SDL with higher mean scores compared to female. However, the higher the year of study, the more students are likely to have good readiness for self-directed learning. Now, as I also took this as my project for completion of MHPE, the coursework is complete, and I'm shortly going to deposit my thesis for that. So based on this pilot study, we will extend this survey, or rather we have extended this survey to the major public and private medical colleges of Khyber Pakhtunkhwa to assess undergraduate medical students' readiness for self-directed learning, especially in this new era of COVID-19 pandemic. Thank you very much, and I'm thankful to you for giving me this opportunity.
Thank you very much.
Thank
sir.
You very much, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Actually, this is the era where everything has been conducted online, and we are also conducting the online lectures for the MBBS classes, and we are also planning to have examination system, assessment system through this. So this was a very good study, which added to our knowledge. We are moving ahead of our time, and we are thankful to our presenters and worthy teachers to strictly following the time. Now I request Professor Dr. Rizwan Hashim for his lecture on the topic of liquid biopsy opportunities and expectations. Let me introduce Professor Dr. Rizwan Hashim Saab. He is a very focused, vibrant, and resilient personality, and professor and head of Department of Pathology and Medical Education at Fazaya Medical College, Air University, Islamabad. Has got keen interest in the innovative topics and the developments related to the chemical pathology. So this topic of liquid biopsy will be new to our our audience here, as well as to the participants. Thank you very much, sir. Sir, will you join us?
Yes, I have joined you.
Thank you very much, sir. Sir, please start. Thank you.
Yes, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. I am thankful to all the organizers, the chief patron, principal, and the head of pathology department along with the patron of the Society of Chemical Pathology, General Farooq Ahmed Khan, president of the Society of Chemical Pathology, Brigadier Amir Ijaz, and president-elect General Reza Jafar. And I'm so thankful to all the team members and the team leaders of Rahim Yar Khan Sheikh Zayed Medical College, who have really put in a wonderful show for this virtual and excellent academic meeting for the Pakistan Society of Chemical Pathology. Now, coming to my topic of liquid biopsy, I would just share that in April 2020, the Bulletin of the Royal College of Pathologists has really emphasized the genomic testing and pathology and has dedicated a number of pages in order to understand that how genomic testing can be done and how will it contribute to the various branches of pathology, not only histopathology, but the various branches of pathology. This topic may sound new, but it has been discussed in various with various aspects in the various conferences of Pakistan Society of Chemical Pathology. My sequence of presentation that I shall introduce this topic will define the process of liquid biopsy, will provide the information regarding the indications, and will compare the tumor biopsy or the histopathology biopsy with the current concept of liquid biopsy, summarize and just give a few references. Now this, with regard to the diagnosis of cancer, there's a whole paradigm shift with regard to the diagnosis of cancer. It is now no longer being diagnosed on the morphological pattern using the HNE stain or the immunological marker, but it has now progressed to the analysis of DNA, RNA and micro RNA analysis by using various platforms. Now with this, the whole concept of deciphering information with regard to the mutations and heterogeneity of the various tumors has been introduced by analyzing the circulating tumor cells, the cell-free DNA, RNA, and the exosome. I shall introduce these terminologies to you in a short while. Another important information is that the this liquid biopsy provides the information regarding the mutation and heterogeneity of the genetic information with regard to the tumor. That that can be done in a very non-invasive way. It is not necessary that you need to really go in and biopsy the tumor, but the whole concept that the tumor cells, they release this information into the bloodstream is the main source and the main principle on which this liquid biopsy analysis is. And another this is providing another piece of information that the tumor heterogeneity is with regard to that the genetic information over the various places of metastasis is quite different from that of the tumor genotyping at the primary site. So this is another important piece of information. So in liquid biopsy, what we do, we use non-invasive methods and we use various medium. It may be blood, saliva, urine, or fluid in order to detect the circulating tumor cells along with the various fragments of the DNA which are shed by the primary tumor or from the various metastatic sites. Now the concept is the principal basis and the concept is that the tumor, they are the tumor cells, they are in a constant phase of proliferation, and during this process of proliferation they are releasing these whole tumor cells into the bloodstream or into the tissue spaces which can re-enter into the bloodstream by the process of through the lymphatics or directly to the bloodstream. And beside it, there is another process of inflammation going on, which results in the necrosis of these tumor cells. And another concept of apoptosis, that depending on the natural process of life cycle of these tumor cells, they go under the process of apoptosis and they release, they break down and they release the circulating tumor DNA. These are the free tumor DNAs, RNA, or the micro RNA besides the various proteins that we use as our tumor markers, because chemical pathology has been involved and has been the pioneer of analysis of the various tumor markers which used to give the various categories of information with regard to the tumor volume, turnover, recurrence, monitoring, therapy. Now the same information is also being provided by the circulating tumor cells, circulating tumor DNA, RNA, and the micro RNA. Another concept of the exosomes, I shall explain it in a short while. So the for the liquid biopsy samples, it is not only the blood and which is further processed and separated from the from elements to the plasma. The these circulating tumor cells and the cell-free DNA can also be collected from the urine, CSF, and saliva also. Now, the concept of the circulating tumor cells. This was in 19th century that T.R. Ashworth conceived and demonstrated the tumor epithelial cell from the breast carcinoma of a patient, which was similar to that of the primary tumor cell that were biopsies. And beyond that, he also deciphered the various types of the these cell-free DNA for analysis. Now the important thing is that it is not only the circulating tumor cells or the circulating tumor cells-free DNA. Beside this, the process of necrosis and apoptosis is going on with the rest of the tumor, the non-tumor cells of the body, may be the WBCs, lymphocyte, and all these cells. So the volume or the quantity of the circulating tumor cells, this is very, very less as compared to the other circulating cells or the nucleated cells, which have got the normal configuration of the human genetics. So it is really a tough job to find these circulating tumor cells when compared to that of the cells that are containing the normal genome of the person. Now these are the various methodologies which can be used in order to separate the tumor circulating cells from the rest of the cells which are carrying the normal genomic process. So the process of filtration using gradient fields, electric fields, or the by the process of negative selection or positive selection by using the various antibodies, these tumor cells, they are isolated from the rest of the cells of the body which have the normal genomic structure. And the tumor cell, they have got the abnormal genomic structure or the mutated genomic structure. Now, the process is that there's an affected patient, we collect the sample, we use the various technologies that have been previously mentioned, we isolate this tumor cell, and then we use the various platforms. It may be immunostaining, this FISH fluorescent immuno in situ hybridization technique, genetic sequences, real-time PCR expression analysis, and even cell culture in order to find the mutation, various mutations within the tumor cells. Now, what is circulating tumor DNA? This is, as I've already elaborated, that by the process of apoptosis and necrosis, these these DNA, they are released into the circulation, may it be lymphatic, may it be within the interstitial spaces, but in the end, they do enter into the bloodstream. The difference between this apoptosis and necrosis is that the whole large sheets of DNA intact, they are released into the bloodstream. But with regard to the necrosis, the small fragments of the DNA, they are released into the bloodstream. But they are carrying the information with regard to the various mutations in the tumor cells. Now, another important thing is that if we separate this plasma, the half-life or the life of these circulating tumor cells, they are very short, only a few, from 15 minutes to a few hours. So they need to be immediately, or the tubes need to have the certain preservatives which can preserve the circulating DNA. Otherwise, it will be lysed by the various enzymes, and they can be stored at minus 80 degrees centigrade ultra freezers, and they can be used later on for analysis. Now, the workflow is we collect the sample, we separate them, we store them, and then we separate and then we separate this circulating DNA and use various platforms. May it be real-time PCR or next-generation sequencing for analysis. Now, what are these exosomes and microvesicles? Now, these exosomes and microvesicles are also the membrane-bound vesicles, which are, by the process of exocytosis, they are released into the bloodstream. And they also carry the microRNA, RNA, and the DNA fragments, and they carry the information of mutation with regard to the tumor cells. So they have also, and these are membrane bound, and they are not easily digested by the various enzymes. So they can also be used for the DNA analysis. Now, another important concept that has been introduced is with regard to the microenvironment of these tumor cells, and they have conceived that the these tumor educated platelets, they also can be used, their genetic information can be used with regard to understand the various types of mutations within the tumor, as well as their response or the tumor response with regard to the resistance to the various modalities of treatment. Now, the indications about this liquid biopsy is that if we resect a tumor or use radiotherapy, chemotherapy, or adjuvant therapies, so how much the residual disease is left. So the volume of the circulating DNA, they do identify this minimal residual disease, and this forms the basis of that whether the disease is going to recur or not. In experimental models in which the tumor was introduced into the mice and then resected, it was only within few hours that the circulating DNA volume was reduced. It also, in order to find whether the treatment is appropriate or the tumor is resistant to the treatment, this circulating DNA is analyzed, and it reflects whether the mutations that are being treated, they are susceptible to the regimen or not. And they can also be used for the disease progression as well as the monitoring of the disease. Another important information is that they also provide the whether the genetic heterogeneity is there with of the tumor with regard to the metastatic disease or the metastatic sites, as well as that of the primary sites. So if the treatment needs to be tailored, which would address both the primary site as well as the metastasis site of the disease. Another information is that if the therapy is only directed toward the genetic mutation of the primary site, it might be that with this treatment, the sites where the metastasis has occurred might not resolve, might not resolve. So appropriate therapy needs to be used. Now, this is a comparison of the analysis capability of the mutation, epigenetic, and the use of the RNA, this transcription profile, when we use the cell-free DNA exosomes or the circulating tumor cells. So they, a comparison is there, which is suitable for what sort of study. Now, these are the various panels. These are the various panels which have been introduced to be used by the real-time PCR or the NGS in order to find the various mutations and then the treatment that can be and the treatment that can be directed towards each panel or each type of mutation. So the liquid biopsy gives you the advantage that you can take the serial evaluation and blood samples in order to find out whether your treatment is directed towards these mutations or not. Now, just a few words about the comparison between the tumor biopsy and the liquid biopsy. The tumor biopsy is limited despite the use of ultrasound guided or the CT guided this tissue biopsy, but it can be very dangerous because the side effects are about 17% in thoracic biopsies and the various percentage with regard to the biopsies of when endoscopic biopsies are used for colorectal cancers or not, or the various deep-seated. So liquid biopsy is non-invasive. It reflects the tumor heterogeneity, and only a few copies of the DNA can show you that the tumor is present or not. And the collection of the fluid and the blood samples are easy. You can have a serial evaluation to find out whether your treatment is working or not, and the evaluation of the resistance is can also be managed quite early. Whether the tissue biopsies are going to end, there are two schools of thoughts who are advocating that the sensitivity when the this liquid biopsy is negative, whether the tumor exists or not, the sensitivity of this technique is about 40 to 50%. So those who are involved in or who advocate tissue biopsy, they advocate that the sensitivity is poor. And the other school of thought that advocates the use of the liquid biopsy, they say that the specificity, that once the cell-free DNA, the mutations or the circulating tumor cell, they are detected, that is about 98 to 99% that the tumor is there. So in conclusion, this liquid biopsy provides us the platform with, to analyze the various types of mutations, may it be, and to address the process of heterogeneity of the mutation at the primary site as well as the secondary site, and by using the various platforms of FISH, quantitative PCR or real-time PCR, next generation sequencing, we can be sure with regard to the various mutations that are there. And this also provides the real-time information to the oncologist whether their drugs are working or not. These are the few references that you can see later on. This is the end of my talk, and I am thankful to Sheikh Zayed Medical College and the Pakistan Society of Chemical Pathology chapter for giving me this chance. Thank you very much. Best wishes.
Thank you very much, sir, for introducing us to this new topic of liquid biopsy, which is actually emerging as a minimally invasive, repeatable, inexpensive method for assessing the tumor DNA, understanding the tumor heterogeneity and monitoring the therapy, prognosis, and the resistance to the therapy and drug resistance in cancer. Thank you very much, sir. So now I conclude with these remarks. Today we make the history, and today we begin to learn, to look through the eyes of others, to find out and experience the new horizons. It is also the day that we grow bigger than our differences and offer everyone, regardless the historical rights and wrongs. My message from this ties, as a moderator and as executive council member of Pakistan Society of Chemical Pathology, that I want to greet a friendly welcome and outstretch appreciative hand to you all. Thank you very much. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make things easy for all of us. Thank you very much, Shaz. Thank you very much for bearing with us. Thanks a lot. Now I will call. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Let me have a short remark. I just want to appreciate whatever you have said. That is so true. This is really a historical day. You have done a wonderful job. And at one moment, your number of participants were 62. Still, they are 60. And I
Yes, sir.
It's really history. Now, one request to you is make a group photo and preserve it for our next issue of the Spectrum. But most importantly, our group photo is that we have, I have already shared on in the group that multiple online screens of the people, online participation. So we, all these pictures will be part of our next issue of the Spectrum. So that was my request. And the three speakers, the talks were really wonderful. I'm saying it from the core of my heart. Professor Asma talked very well on a current topic, and it really enlightened us. Then the talk by Professor Ijaz Khattak, that is very close to my heart because I'm also a medical educationist, and that gives an incentive for all the undergraduate teachers to carry out, to start this project of self-directed learning. And I'll talk to Professor Ijaz to extend the project to all over the Pakistan. Last but not the least, Professor Rizwan really enlightened all of us, especially I learned a lot. I learned new things in his talk. As usual, he's the pioneer of giving new technologies, talking about new technologies of the future. And this CTC, cell-free DNA, I think this is our future. And this will probably, as on a lighter tone, I will say, make our histopathologist colleagues unemployed. So, well done, three speakers, and you have done a wonderful job. Thank you, Dr. Spath, for giving me this.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much. I'm really encouraged. I'm really thankful to our worthy guest here, head of departments of pediatrics, of physiology, anatomy, and so on. Now I'll call Mr. Senior Technologist, Mr. Ali Malik, to come on the dais for the shield distribution. Sir, stay with us for the next few minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Dr. Spahad, and thank you very much all the participants to grace us in this historical event, ChemCon 2020. For the shield distribution, I would like to request Principal Professor Dr. Tariq Ahmed Saab to please come on the stage for distribution of shields, along with Head of Pathology Department, Professor Dr. Abdul Rahman Saab, to join Principal Saab. I would like to call Professor Dr. Salman Khan Saab, Professor of Histopathology, Multimedia Bantu. Thank you, sir. Now I request Professor of Microbiology, Professor Dr. Mohammad Shahbaz Hussain Saab. Sir, please. Now I request to Professor Dr. Mohammad, Associate Professor Dr. Mohammad Bilal Ghafoor Saab, Section in Charge Hematology and Blood Bank and Thalassemia. Now I would like to call Associate Professor Dr. Subhat Tariq. He is also in charge of Section of Clinical Pathology. Dr. Nabila Rauf, Assistant Professor, Chemical Pathology. Dr. Umar Khalid Chima, Assistant Professor, Microbiology. In charge IT department, Dr. Mohammad Bilal Ghafoor Saab, and Farhan Saab. We are highly thankful to them for their support in this online virtual conference, CAMP 2020. Now I request to Professor Dr. Masood Al-Haq Saab, Head of Pulmonology Department. Dr. Agha Tohid Ahmed Saab, Medical Superintendent, Sheikh Zayed Hospital, Ranger Khan. Professor Dr. Mohammad Abdul Rahman Saab, Pattern of ChemCon 2020, Head of Pathology Department, Professor Dr. Mohammad Abdul Rahman Saab. Now I request to Professor Saab to present shield to Principal Professor Dr. Tariq Ahmed Saab. At the end, me, Muhammad Ali Malik. अभी ग्रुप फोटो के लिए चल रहे हैं, हमने कॉलेज के एंट्रेंस पे, उसके बाद हाई टी का रेंज है आप सबके लिए, और कल का सेशन इंशाल्लाह 9 बजे एग्जैक्ट स्टार्ट हो जाएगा, 9 AM शार्प कल का लेक्चर और वर्कशॉप वो एग्जैक्ट 9 बजे शुरू हो जाएगी। अभी हम ग्रुप फोटो के लिए चलेंगे कॉलेज के एंट्रेंस पे, फिर उसके बाद पैथोलॉजी डिपार्टमेंट में हाई टी का रेंज है आप सब लोगों के लिए। थैंक यू वेरी मच।